Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Arco Timmermans, and I'm Professor of Public Affairs at the Campus The Hague of Leiden University, and also Research Director of the Montesquieu Institute, which studies parliamentary democracies in the European Union. And today I'm going to introduce you into the course Perspectives on the European Crisis. And I do that by introducing you into the world of thinking about the dynamics of attention. I will try to explain to you a lens on attention in the sphere of politics and also in society and all kinds of actors and stakeholders that poke their nose into the matter of European and economic policymaking. And maybe also social policymaking and cultural policymaking and the concerns that we as citizens across the European Union have. For this reason, the title of my presentation is Ignorance or Emphasis, either of the two, because often in the real world of agenda setting and the concerns of citizens and the headlines of newspapers, we see that issues come and go. Sometimes the whole front page is devoted to a disaster, a crisis, a focus event, a new development that is a matter of concern, but then in the coming days, the following days, we see the attention waning again. And this seems to be the case also for politics. So how can we understand this? How can we explain this phenomenon? Therefore, I'm going to introduce you into a theoretical lens, but I hope to make that so clear and empirically visible to you that you can actually apply this lens in the remaining part of this course, which consists of as many as 32 lectures, all taped by my colleagues across the European Union. So today, we have as a theme the question whether the members of the Eurozone, in having the Euro, are actually singing the same song, or actually we hear dissonance across the chorus that lead to trouble. And looking back in time since the outbreak of the European crisis, the Euro crisis, we indeed have heard very different kinds of tone and songs indeed. So recent elections in Germany have shown that Angela Merkel made a landslide victory, will form and be in charge of forming a new government. And as you can see in this cartoon, she is gaining indeed strength in carrying the weight of European monetary and economic policy making. Germany as an important member state may even become more important at the center of European policy making and political attention. Over time, looking back, you can see that the level, the rate, the exchange rate of the euro has gone up and down. We witness now an increasing stability of the euro, but that involves political costs. We witness the variation between member states in how publics and political leaders think about how to move on. So we cannot really say that there is a solution yet to the problems of the European crisis, even including the euro. Therefore, why is it useful to look at political attention? And how does that link to the overall theme of the course, Perspectives on the European Crisis? We have now, since the membership of Croatia, 28 member states. We have divides across the countries and across the publics, as we also hear later in this course, between big or small member states, between north and south countries, the northern member states that often, and the western ones that often advocate a more stringent monetary policy, and the countries that are actually witnessing the consequences of this, that are actually at the same time also the importers of the goodies of the northern member states oftentimes. And another divide is then between the monetary hawks versus the doves, who advocate more investment in labor and in stimulation of the economy. And I believe that in the coming years, and that's one of the reasons why this course is going to be very important, not only to us as participants, but also to the broader public, and maybe even to the leaders, is that these types of divides will not so easily be settled in the coming time. So therefore, it's even more necessary to exchange perspectives and the beliefs and views that we have as students and professors engaged in this area of study. In this course, there will be at least three dimensions of the European crisis in the attention, in the spotlights, beginning with the economic aspects. Colleagues from departments of economics giving their view on this, and you will be hopefully inspired to share your perspectives on these views, followed by political and institutional aspects of the European crisis. Do we need more federalization in the European Union, or perhaps do we need to transfer competencies back to the member states, as many parties in member states are advocating? So these issues are going to be important as well, and therefore they are also addressed extensively in this course. And finally, and certainly not least, social and cultural aspects of the European crisis. Are we witnessing an identity crisis of citizens living in the different member states that tend to vote for parties taking distance or taking stock against European integration? So social and cultural elements are absolutely crucial to understanding the European crisis. These all will be addressed in this course, and today my introduction attempts to show that these dimensions do not always attract the same level of attention at one point in time. There is competition for attention even between underlying dimensions of problems. That makes politics an ever ongoing story, a never ending story in that sense. Therefore, the goal of this course, as a kickoff today, is to share and understand the perspectives, and the work that you'll be doing in the coming weeks is very much about this. Then let's consider a little bit more. Why is it then useful to study political attention? For political scientists like me, that may be an obvious focal point of analysis in the countries that we see around. And maybe looking at the European agenda as it develops over time and the priorities that government leaders and heads of state make. But there is a broader reason for this. At least there are three. First of all, we don't really know much about the development of attention over time. And we can learn a lot by systematically analyzing this. It also helps us to answer the question whether our country, we have 8 countries in this course, is actually unique in the patterns of attention, public opinion, news headlines that we see, or are there similarities across countries, despite all the differences that we are aware of? Maybe there is underlying similarities that we haven't seen yet. What can we learn from them? The second point is that, and very importantly, attention waves cut across political and administrative planning and expectations, promises that politicians make, electoral pledges, government programs, annual budgets, that all are talk and often numbers about policy intentions and planning. But the real world of political attention is, at least for the other half, a matter of reaction to unexpected events. For example, the outbreak of the economic crisis was, at least to many, not entirely foreseen, and we see the intense reactions all over the world to this outbreak of the crisis in late 2007 and the years since then. So how much do we actually encounter tales of the unexpected when we are studying politics and we look at the real world of priorities that political leaders make? And finally, also important to what we witness facing the upcoming parliamentary elections for the European Parliament in May next year, there are legitimacy problems that often induce politicians to engage in more institutional tinkering and inventing solutions. But actually what we see there is that with more promises and more input to the political machinery, this machinery is not always able to process all these demands and expectations, so there is even a risk. And if you cannot foresee the development of attention, you also cannot plan how you deliver your promises. And that, as a consequence, leads to legitimacy problems and the so-called democratic deficit problem in the European Union that also exists in our home countries, for example, in the relationship between citizens and national parliaments. Here are some examples about the rise and fall of attention over time. This one is taken from the Netherlands. Recently, we had 2 weeks ago the annual Queen's Speech, where this time the King, for the first time, pronounced the new plans for the year. And what we see in this graph is for 3 policy fields, economic in blue, immigration and citizens' rights in the light green, and in red we see justice and criminality, law and order issues. Over time, in the past 20 years in the Netherlands, we see how these three issues have developed in very different directions, with economics, not surprisingly, rising sharply in attention, and the other topics declining in attention, even though many citizens don't believe, including politicians, that these problems have already been solved. But it shows that attention often involves competition. Issues compete for attention. And that is also the case at the European level. So now we all witness and have the most important problem, economy and jobs and the monetary stability. But what about climate change? What about terrorism? What about other issues, social, cultural, that come across the features in the newspapers and that are still matters of concern but are driven away by the issues that are now apparently most urgent? So how can we understand this process? Another example, this is a graph that shows the relative distribution of attention between five member states in the European Union and the European Council. The zero line is an equal level of attention between these member states and the European Council, and everything that goes up and down shows that the tension is relatively large at either the member state level or within the European Council. And from this graph, you can see that actually there is a lot of shifts across member states and the European Council when it comes to attention to macroeconomics. And that suggests that there is maybe a substitution effect in the attention, or maybe there is something else at work that we haven't understood well thus far. So therefore, this graph also may stir more thinking about what we know about the dynamics of attention in a European Union where the member states must coordinate and must come to agreement, for example in the European Council, about what the next steps will be with regard to the euro and other matters of European integration, and how that feeds back into the national publics. Here another graph that shows the three main issues in the European Council: economics, the architecture of the European Union as such, the institutions, and international affairs, including world politics. And it shows that these three themes sometimes make up most of the whole agenda of the European Council, but in other years they decline and then there is more space for other issues. So this graph is another illustration of the competition for attention between all kinds of policy problems that may occur. But apparently they are not receiving the same amount of attention over time. That is the same process as we see in the headlines of newspapers. It works in the same way in politics, but what are the consequences? How long do we need to capture attention to the economy to actually implement all the solutions that we have? Or do we reach the end of our patience with economic policy, and do we need to shift to other issues, for example, because publics have expectations about these issues? How much can we still play the card about monetary stability if unemployment, including a country like the Netherlands that always had a very high employment rate, is rising steeply, not even to mention the southern member states? These are real problems to citizens. How do politicians respond to them? A question that you can connect to this type of graph. It's only an illustration. And then, to generalize from these pictures, our lesson is so far that attention shows a wave pattern of up and down over time. And not only we see an up and down pattern of attention, we also see changes in the way problems are perceived. Problems can have a technical definition. It can be delegated to expert communities or to the European Commission for fine print policy making. But it can also rise again and take a more dramatic character, which often is sparked by politicians who want to mobilize support, for example, when elections are coming. So over time, most of the issues that we can think of show a wave pattern of up and down. And that is important because when an issue is rising in attention, it has consequences for expectations of citizens. And when it goes down in attention, it has consequences for the possibility to hold on to policy implementation. Or maybe the issue is then driven away by other issues that are becoming more urgent in the beliefs and the perceptions of politicians and citizens, and in the news headlines, and maybe also in the eyes of experts who advise on what to prioritize. The lessons from these kinds of analysis that I've shown in the past slides are that attention follows what we call a power law. A power law is a law from physics that says that, consider for example a slope with a large object that is heavy. It's hard to move the object, but since the slope is declining, if you push it, it may not be possible to stop it anymore once it has set in motion. That is the power law of attention that we then apply in our research studying political agenda dynamics to the world of politics. And what we see here is that the European Union is a multitasking system with directorates, with countries, with all their ministries, so they can actually deal with many issues at the same time, but yet some issues are so urgent that they need priority. Which are these issues? And that is because attention is a scarce resource. We cannot devote all our attention to many issues at the same time if these issues become urgent. We need to work in serial processing about these issues. Information processing capacity is limited despite the large machineries of government that we have created in the past decades that is done to actually process many issues and problems at the same time. But again, when issues become dramatic and urgent, they drive out other issues from attention, and then political leaders must make decisions on them. Publics expect those decisions. But the real world also tells us that institutions have a conservative bias. They are sticky to what issues are actually considered. So it is not so easy for a new issue to enter the agenda if there have been large and costly investments in policy programs that were just initiated. So that is attention, responsiveness versus that was the light that went out, that sometimes happens in life, responsiveness versus planning of policy attention. And the consequence is, with these bottlenecks in attention and with this competition for attention between issues, that attention to a problem often shows a pattern of inaction and overreaction. There is very little attention to problems. They are withheld from the agenda. Consider, for example, the Growth and Stability Pact that we already have. For long times, and it was only after the enormous impulses of the economic crisis that flew over from the United States that European leaders started to respond, because the problems were so urgent that they could not be ignored anymore. But the same problems in a smaller extent were already visible much earlier. But at those times, for example, if you look at the development of the Growth and Stability Pact, the drastic decisions that were taken recently were not taken earlier. So, in other words, the response is often not proportionate to the type of problem that we witness. It is disproportionate, and if it is disproportionate, it may involve that we react perhaps too strongly to a problem. That is an evaluative decision. I cannot inform you about this decision. This is, of course, also a decision or an insight that we have to achieve through the exchange that we have in the coming weeks. Is there an overreaction, or do we actually think that there was still insufficient reaction? For example, by not making decisions about the political integration that, according to many, is necessary to have a stable monetary and economic basis in the European member states. To express the nature of attention and the change in attention for issues over time, that wave pattern, we have a graph here that shows you all the changes in attention to issues in the European Council. And what this graph shows is that the distribution of these changes indeed is not normal, but is, as we call in statistical terms, leptokurtic. It means that the ends of the frequency distribution with very little change and very big change are visible in the high bars. So the bar close to the x-axis is showing all the changes away from an issue with 100%. An issue disappears from the agenda, and as this graph shows, that happened quite often. So sacrificing issues in order to emphasize others is a frequent pattern. On the other side of the graph, we also see that when there is an increase in attention to a problem, for example, economics, then the increase is not just with a few percents, but can be with hundreds of percents. And that is the graph on the other side of the bar on the other side of the graph that shows you. So this statistical picture shows actually, it's based on empirical data of the European Council agenda since the 70s, it shows how much this story about large attention shifts and small attention shifts and not moving away from an issue occurs in reality. The consequence of this, knowing these developments and types of dynamics, is that it is often very hard to make decisions about rising emphasis, increasing attention to a problem or not, and make hard choices about reforms and austerity policy or on labor market interventions or our pensions or maybe setting rules for immigration because we believe that such rules are part of the solution to problems, which actually may not be to curb immigration but to stimulate immigration, to facilitate the single European market and the labor migration patterns that we have across the expanding number of member states, if we look back in time. So the lessons that we draw from this research is that hard choices that we make and that we need to actually to build support in our societies, they need a window of opportunity. They are not just enforceable like this. They need a very careful timing. But how can you predict that this moment occurs? That's a big dilemma for political decision makers, and we may in the coming time exchange our ideas about how we see such windows in the real world, in our countries, or maybe at the European level, in the Commission or in the European Council, or maybe even in the Court of Justice or in the European Central Bank that is in a way also a policymaker within the boundaries that it has. It is also true that hard choices like major reforms that we are witnessing in so many of our countries deemed necessary for economic and monetary reasons, they need stable priorities. But the previous slides and the story that I've told you actually indicates that such stability is always temporary. It is interrupted by large shifts in attention because other issues intrude on the agenda in our scope of concern. So that makes political priorities very vulnerable to interruptions. How can we maintain attention so long that we are able to actually implement the policy solutions that we were designing and that were already so difficult to settle politically? And finally, hard choices never come at the right moment. We are confronted with the need for reforms. We, of course, make political decisions to do this, and it needs goodwill to do this too. But they never come at the right moment. So how long do you wait? How long did the European member states wait with adapting the Growth and Stability Pact? In hindsight, perhaps too long. So that is a nice illustration of postponement of decisions that may have been taken before. And that is because attention at the time when we saw weak signals, indicators of violations of the Growth and Stability Pact, were politically not translatable into action. For example, because large member states were the ones violating the 3% norm, as happened in the mid-2000s. For hard choices, big reforms, in that sense, perhaps solutions, if we take a perspective on the European crisis that are still contested, there are many obstacles and opportunities. So how to detect these, how to understand when such obstacles are really obstacles in the way and when opportunities, windows of opportunities are opening? That is a typical question that you can ask from an agenda setting and a politics of attention perspective. But we know also that there are many veto players that are taking sides against supporters of ideas. We also witness that focus events often happen, and they need not even be economic and monetary focusing events. They can also be other types of events that intrude on the agenda and need patience to return to the issues that we hadn't solved yet, but that were moved a little bit to the margins of our scope of attention. That is important because that may, for this reason, mean that we have to wait with the right moment to find agreement among political leaders or to convince our national publics. There is also spillover from other issues. An issue can change in color, in nature, in definition, with the rise and decline, as I showed you on the earlier picture. And that has consequences because linkages between issues are the currency, the trademark of politicians. They link issues because they want to broaden the scope of debate. And issues, for the same reason, also travel. They travel across policy domains and they travel across national boundaries, which we, for example, witness when we see how, in the preparation of the European elections in May next year, party families are trading their issues in order to come to common views on problems and solutions. And the same happens with social media, where citizens express their views. In this sense, we are all facilitating the traveling of issues, the points of our of concern that we have. And finally, policy agendas, as a consequence, are always a mixture of planning and reaction. So we cannot all predict what happens tomorrow, but we must respond to issues when they are urgent. In this introduction, I've mentioned the importance of attention because it drives what politicians and publics believe and what they find important to address. We witness in the past years economic downturns. We witness increasing unemployment. So what is the conclusion of this introduction? First of all, that with 28 member states, patterns of attention, and I think each of you in the 8 countries that are present in this course will witness this, patterns of attention vary widely. We cannot assume that the same issues are at the same time the most important ones in the member states. We may debate this. Do we have enough attention for social issues, for cultural issues? What are the burning issues with regard to employment in countries where employment is not declining as hard as in other countries? So this is a matter of what is the most salient issue and how can we build political support to move on. This is a dilemma for European integration that is certainly not solved yet. Second, political tension is not just planning, it is also reacting. It means that we cannot always assume that what we write down in election platforms and in government documents is the only reality of our priorities. Often priorities are forced because of unforeseen developments and events that happen. And they acquire meaning because they are confronting. So we must respond. That is what politicians say and what national publics expect. How do we deal with these insights? What are the implications for wise policy decisions in the future? This is hopefully an element to inspire the debate that you will have in the coming weeks. And third, how to draw lessons with such complexity? It's one thing to say that dynamics of political tension varies across countries and is complex and shows different patterns and wave patterns over long-term periods, but how to move from this, from these insights, if we acknowledge the complexity? Well, then one way to start dealing with this is to actually do what we are doing in this course, which is to learn by interaction, to share perspectives and viewpoints in order to understand and learn for the future. So that is one of the goals, and that is my final point of today, one of the goals, and maybe even the most important goals of this course, to share perspectives on the European crisis and be aware that attention to these issues that compose the crisis and are the constituent elements of what the crisis actually means to us, how that develops and how we can understand this story of framing of the crisis. Hopefully in the coming weeks we will learn a lot, and at the end of this course we'll have the results in which I'm very interested already now. Thank you for your attention.